Praise the Lord. Turn to someone and say, not for housing. You're supposed to be here for salvation, revelation, and eternal life. Are you listening to me? And so we should understand then that this was where he took his text. He preached, and after preaching the baptism of the Holy Ghost, after preaching the gospel, those who heard him wanted to be baptized in water. Said, men and brethren, what shall we do? 3,000 of them were baptized in water in Jesus' name. And no doubt they received the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They were born again in water and spirit. And the church began on the day of Pentecost. And throughout the book of the Acts of the Apostles, you will see throughout that book that it talks about how the gospel is confirmed. And so the confirmation of the gospel is in the book of Acts. The beginning of the gospels are in the four gospels. And this is what the church is supposed to be preaching. Not only the beginning, but also it is supposed to be preaching the confirmation, or how the gospel is to be confirmed in the life of the believer. Through repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, and receiving the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And going on to know him, someone say, through revelation. So repeat after me, revelation. Or excuse me, repeat after me, salvation. Revelation. And eternal life. That is what the purpose of the church is in the life of the believer. Now we are confronted with a very dangerous day. I'll give you some scriptures both from the Old and New Testament so that you can see what we are struggling with today with regard to the spirit of our dispensation, which is called the Laodicean church age. Let's go now to the book of Isaiah chapter 4. We want to ask all of you to participate, all of you to read. Some of you have been in the church for many years and you feel that you know the Bible, but if I ask you to teach a Bible study, you wouldn't be able to teach one. Praise the Lord. Even though you may know the Bible, you must understand that of the seven parables found in the 13th chapter, I believe it is, of the Gospel according to St. Matthew, you may remember the words of Jesus where he said, therefore every scribe which is instructed unto the kingdom of heaven is like unto a man that is an householder, which bringeth forth out of his treasure things new and old. And so you should understand that the scribe is the pastor. The kingdom of heaven is the church. And he is likened unto a man that is an householder. The householder that the scribe is over is the local assembly, which bringeth forth out of his treasure things new and old. The treasure is the mind of the pastor. Now, there is another scripture in Corinthians where Paul wrote and said that we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Did you ever stop to think about where that treasure is? It is in the mind and the heart of the pastor. Because Jesus also said that out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. And where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. So when Paul said that we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of ourselves, the treasure, or the place where the depository of the individual ministry, where God places his information, is in the mind of the minister. And then when it comes time, the Holy Spirit brings that up out of his mind. Now, I will agree that everything that comes to us comes by way of our mind. It is filtered by the Holy Spirit. If we're led by the Holy Spirit or guided by the Holy Spirit will filter things that are of God and that are not of God. If we will allow the Holy Spirit to work, when God sends things from the Holy Spirit to us, then the sending anointing from the teacher will send it, and this receiving anointing in you will receive it. Are you listening to me? And when the sending anointing from the teacher sends God's word, and the receiving anointing is confirming or is receptive or is working in your life and you receive it, then you get the picture. And then, of course, as you receive it, then it becomes a part of your resolve. It is put in your heart. It is put in my heart. If I'm the one sitting receiving teaching, it is put in my heart. If I'm the one teaching, sending it out, comes out of my heart as the Holy Spirit brings it up out of my mind. And of course, it is imparted to you. Then you receive it, and the Holy Spirit records it in your heart. After all, this is where he is writing it. He said, I will put my laws in your mind and write them where? In your heart. This is the new covenant. This is what he is doing. Are you listening to me? And so this is then how we get our understanding. And of course, then God is able to reveal things to us. But he reveals things unto us by his Spirit. And to make light of the Holy Spirit, not allow it to work, not be where it has ordained or God has ordained for us to be, for it to work in our life, is a mistake of the child of God today. And this is why many people that come in the church don't benefit in totality from salvation. And certainly because even though they receive salvation, they never submit themselves to God to receive revelation that they may go on to perfection. And consequently, their salvation is incomplete in and of itself. If they don't go on to know, then it is spoken of in the 6th chapter of the book of Hebrews, that they crucify the Son of God afresh and put him to open shame, because they do not allow themselves to come into the principles, leave them, and go on to perfection. Praise the Lord. So in the book of Isaiah chapter 4, this is a prophecy of the attitude of those in the church dispensation, particularly in each of the 7 dispensations. There has been a degree of this attitude among some of the people of God. But primarily, this is the attitude that is spoken of in the Laodicean church. Someone say the Laodicean church. And this is what this is referencing here. All right. Verse 1 is all we're interested in. Let's read of Isaiah chapter 4. And in that day, 7 women shall take hold of one man, saying, we will eat our own bread and wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by thy name to take away our reproach. Can the church say amen? Now, he goes on to talk about Zion in verses 2 and 3. I simply want to focus on verse number 1. In that day, that is in the church dispensation, particularly in the Laodicean church age of the church dispensation. 7 women. The number 7 is God's number of completion. For there are how many days in creation? There are 7 days in creation. Are there not? Praise the Lord. And so God's number is of completion is 7. They're the 7 church ages. Praise the Lord. They're the 7 spiritual blessings. Praise the Lord. There are the 7 promises of God in Psalms 91. There are the 7 stages of perfection that we read about and believe in 2 Peter chapter 1. And there are the 7 fruit of repentance. I can go on and on and on. 7 is God's number of completion. Are you listening to me? Well, this has to do with the sum total of the 7 church ages, the sum total of the church dispensation at that day, 7 women. And of course, the church is likened unto a woman. The church is referred to as the mother of us all. In your Bible, it says Jerusalem, which is above, is the mother of us all. So in that day, 7 women shall take hold of one man. Now, this interesting expression, shall take hold of one man. Those of us that are in the church, we are in him. We are not taking hold of him. We are in the one man. We are referred to as the body of Christ. We are referred to now because we are the body of Christ, the man Christ Jesus. He's no longer here in the flesh because he's working through us. And he's preaching through us. He's saving through us. And how are people coming into Christ? For the Bible said, if any man be in Christ. So we're not taking hold of him. We are in him. But this expression, seven women shall take hold of one man. These are those that want to use the church in the name of the church for their own benefit. This is why this expression is here. They are not in Christ. And then, of course, we know that the Bible says the foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knoweth them that are his. Therefore, let everyone the name of the name of Christ take depart from what? Depart from iniquity. So seven women shall take hold of one man, saying, what are they saying? We will eat our own bread. So these are religious people in our day that do not want the word of God. They simply want the benefit of being called saved, being called Christians, being called representatives of Jesus Christ. So turn to someone and say, imposters. This is who this is speaking of. These are imposters. They do not have salvation. They may have had it. It does not indicate that they did, but if they did have it, they certainly, in this particular description in prophecy in the fourth chapter of Isaiah, verse number 1, don't have it at this time. We will eat our own bread. Well, Jesus said, if any man eateth not my bread or eateth my flesh, excuse me, and drinketh my blood, he has no part of me. And his flesh is meat indeed. His blood is drink indeed. We eat his bread and drink his, or eat his flesh and drink his blood today, which will be the equivalent of eating his bread by receiving the word of God. But the expression in this text is that we will eat our own bread. And this is the attitude of multitudes today. They do not want to receive the word of God, rightly divide it. They want to take the word of God and, of course, discard it and simply put whatever thing in place that they want to put in place and set their own standards of religion up. Now, I'm not trying to speak disrespect to religions, but so many religions do not teach out of the Bible at all. The largest faith in the world does not teach out of the Bible at all. They don't even teach out of the scriptures. Let us eat our own bread and wear our own apparel. Only let us be called by thy name to take away our reproach. The point is, from us reading this scripture and this prophecy tonight, this is the attitude of the religious world today. But this will not work. There is no salvation in this approach to serving God. This will not get it. Those who take this attitude that we will eat our own bread and wear our own apparel has to do with putting garments on to sanctify ourselves. We will call ourselves sanctified, or we will call ourselves saved, based on our interpretation or based on what we see is acceptable. And herein lie the problems in many denominations, and this is why many denominations feel that they can elevate homosexuals to the priesthood and that they can do whatever they want to do. They can change whatever they want in the scripture. They can discard and interpret the scripture any way they choose to do so on any subject, be it the subject of creation, be it the subject of morality or subjects of morality, be it the subject of salvation and the plan of salvation, and or the interpretation of what in fact constitutes the gospel of Jesus Christ and a person being saved. This is the day we live in, and it has gotten progressively worse. Why? Because Jesus gave inspiration to the apostles to write that in the last days Antichrist shall come, already are there Antichrist among you. The interesting thing about this verse is these are those who are antichrist, but yet they want to use his name. The interesting thing about the antichrist is the antichrist is going to come and say he is the Christ. So even though he will be antichrist, he will be trying to use the name of Christ to deceive the people of God, to make them think he is the Christ. And this is the attitude that is prophesied concerning in this particular scripture found in Isaiah chapter 4 and verse number 1. Can the church say amen? Now, the contrary is in verse number 2. Let us read verses 2, verse 2. In that day shall the branch of the Lord be beautiful and glorious, and the fruit of the earth shall be excellent and comely for them that are escaped of Israel. Now, this the primary meaning that the first part of this particular prophecy came to pass when the church was born on the day of Pentecost and has been so through the 2,000-year church dispensation, because they that are escaped of Israel is a remnant. So this expression, for them that are escaped of Israel, there was a remnant saved on the day of Pentecost. The church almost was entirely, or as a matter of fact, on Pentecost, the church was entirely a Jewish church until the Samaritans came in 8 years later in the 8th chapter of the book of Acts, when Peter and John went down to lay hands on the Samaritans after Philip, I believe it was, had preached to the Samaritans the gospel of Jesus Christ. Are you listening to me? Then 2 years after that, the Gentiles came in, 10 years after Pentecost, in the 10th chapter of the book of Acts. And since that time, there's been such a vast influx of Gentiles into the New Testament church. The New Testament church today is almost entirely a Gentile church. There have been a small number of our Jewish brethren that have been saved. Most of our Orthodox Jewish brethren are still waiting on the coming of the Messiah. Not for the church, but the first time. And only because the temple that they used to worship in was destroyed back almost 2,000 years ago. It was referred to as Herod's temple. That temple was destroyed in 70 AD by Titus and his army, if you remember. And it fulfilled the prophecy of Jesus Christ found in the 24th and 25th chapter of the gospel according to Matthew, when they tried to show, the disciples and apostles tried to show Jesus the temple and the beauty of the buildings of Herod's complexes, the court of the Gentiles, the court of the women, the court of the priests, and so on and so forth. That temple, that is the entire complex, was said to take 46 years to complete the entire complex. But they were marveling in it, and Jesus prophesied and said not a stone of the temple would be left standing upon another. And it is said historically, according to the writings of Flavius Josephus, one of the most celebrated Jewish historians in the history of civilization, that when they went in to destroy the temple, it was rumored that there were precious jewels and gems in the hollow of the stones of the temple. So they are supposed to have taken the temple down stone by stone, breaking the stones and looking for gems and jewels in there, only to find there was no such thing. And this then was the fulfillment of the prophecy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So verse number 2 is simply saying that despite the fact that there will be those 7 women who would take hold of one man, or those religious people who would take hold of one man, and that one man is they will try to attach themselves to Jesus Christ and say we will eat our own bread and wear our own apparel, only let us be called by the name to take away our reproach. Yes, they will want their reproach to be taken away, but they will want it to be taken away, not his way, but their way. And this is why there are so many presentations of the gospel today, because people don't want to do it God's way. The main thing people don't want to do is repent. They do not want to stop sinning. Turn to someone and say, folk don't want to stop sinning. And it is the truth, and you know it's the truth. People do not want to stop their mess. They want to go to heaven, but they want to go to heaven their way. And that's just the truth. I'm not trying to speak disrespect to our television audience, but you know how you are. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
I should say you know how we are. Now, we're saved. That's not our attitude. We have given up these things. I was talking to a friend of mine. I said to him, he had had some complications. And I said, now, what you're asking me what you should do. He said, well, I like drinking. I said, you need to give up drinking. I said, after the problems you had, you need to stop drinking. I don't want to stop drinking. I said, well, you asked me. And I'm telling you, you need to stop drinking. Because you have some very serious problems that almost cost you and other people their lives. People don't want to stop doing their mess. Praise the Lord. Drug users want to keep getting high and go to heaven. Alcoholics want to keep drinking and go to heaven. People who are addicted to nicotine want to keep smoking and go to heaven. Everyone wants to justify themselves to do it, whatever they want to do, and still go to God's heaven. Well, the Bible teaches, follow peace with all men, holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. So we should understand that there are and there is a large contingency that is referred to in Isaiah 4 and 1 of individuals in the religious world that want to go to heaven their way. They want to claim salvation their way. They want to claim Christ as their Savior. And they want to use his name but do not want to eat his bread and do not want to wear the garments of holiness. This is why they say, let us wear our own apparel. That has to do with, someone say, lifestyle. This is conversation, manner of living. They want to live the way they want to live and do what they want to do. And when the word of God comes, they want nothing to do with the scriptures. Certainly don't want anything to do with what we teach around here. Praise the Lord. Because oftentimes, even those individuals that I am close to, maybe in terms of my association with them in the world, say that, Reverend, it's a bit too tight for me. Can the church say amen? I say, well, you know, I used to do what you're doing. You can't tell me about sin. I was a rank sinner and did much of what anyone has ever done that has been in sin. With exception, I have not taken anyone's life. Came close, but didn't. Can we say amen? And so this is then how it is. So now it says then in verse 2, but in that day shall the branch of the Lord be beautiful. Someone say the church. The branch of the Lord is Christ. Christ is referred to in your studies. Go back and study. The branch of the Lord is Christ. Praise the Lord. Now, in one place he said, I am the vine and ye are the branches. But understand something. The only way we are the branches is that we have come into who? Christ. We are the body of Christ. Even as the branches, we are what? The body of Christ. So this is referring to the church. We shall be beautiful, glorious, and the fruit of the earth shall be excellent and comely for them that are escaped of Israel. Someone says, well, this is talking about Israel. It is primarily talking about Israel, but because of the fact that as a nation, they rejected him. We were grafted in. It is said in the 11th chapter of the book of Romans that we were what? Grafted in. We are branches that have been what? Grafted in. So we are among those that are referred to as in terms of a secondary meaning. Every scripture has a primary meaning. Yes, the primary meaning is referencing those in Israel that came into the church in the early days. And of course, those that of the remnant that were saved during the church dispensation. And certainly the rest of it is referring to those of us that come in and as well as those of Israel that shall come in and be saved during the tribulation period. Because there will be a remnant saved during the tribulation period. Can the church say amen?
Amen.
Verse 3 read, and it shall come to pass that he that is left in Zion and he that remaineth in Jerusalem shall be called holy. Well, this couldn't be unless they had received the baptism of what? The Holy Ghost. Read on. Even everyone that is written among the living in Jerusalem. So now, this is not fulfilled in its totality. It began on Pentecost. For our brothers in Israel, the remnant that came out, it began on Pentecost for them. We came in because, as a nation, they rejected. And so we got in there. But let me be clear. As you know from your reading here, this is referring to the church in verses 2 and 3. Let me be clear that verse number 1 is letting all of us know that there was a religious contingency in that day that did not want to accept the apostolic doctrine. The scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees wanted to be called by the name of Jehovah, but did not want to eat his bread and wear his apparel. Well, the name Jehovah is what? Jesus the Christ. Did you not know the name Jesus means Jehovah is salvation? Look it up. Can the church say amen? And so even as it was in that day in the early church dispensation, the first church dispensation, Ephesus, it is today. It's just gotten progressively worse. I believe it was Paul that said, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. Jude said, certain men crept in unawares. Now we have then a serious problem on our hands in our day if we do not realize the purpose of us coming to church is salvation, revelation, and eternal life. That's what you're supposed to be here for. Turn to someone and say, not for CCH. You're supposed to be here for salvation, revelation, and eternal climb. Praise the Lord. Turn to someone and say, not for housing. You're supposed to be here for salvation, revelation, and eternal life. Someone say, not to find a husband. You're supposed to be here for salvation, revelation. Turn to someone and say, not to find a wife. Now, if you findeth a wife, you findeth a good thing. But that's not the purpose of us being here. Amen? And God will add things that we need as we go along. Now then, let us go to Isaiah 61. We want to talk about garments, apparel. We're saved folks. Praise the Lord. So, since we're saved people, we know that this is what Jesus quoted when he came preaching repentance. We know this. We read this in St. Matthew 3:16. These are the words of Jesus. So when Jesus quoted this, he made them to know this day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears. You ever read that? Okay, well, I'll take you over there in Matthew chapter 3 as soon as we read it here. Now that we have come in through this scripture, this has been fulfilled in us. We are now, turn to someone and say, I'm living in the scripture. Throw your hands up like this. Say, I'm living in the scripture. And what I'm trying to get you to see is you read this like this is some abstract a vicarious experience. This is not what this is. This is who we are. We read this. We are actually living these scriptures that we're reading about. Another scripture said that ye are a living epistle known and read of all men. So people read this. If you've had this experience, they're reading about you. That's what the Bible's telling you. So a young lady wanted to write a book. She wrote a book, gave me the book. I'm going to read it. And then after I read the book, I'm going to say, now what about God's book? God wrote a book. Have you read his book? Praise the Lord. Everybody writing books around here, I got news for you. God wrote a book. Have you read his book? I read David McCullough's book. David McCullough's book on John Adams is a good book. David McCullough's book on 1776 is a good book. Jake's book on Woman Thou Art Loosed, I never read it, but somebody said it was a good book. Pray, can we say amen? But no book that has ever been written compares to God's book. Because it's the only book you can read and get saved out of.